The topic is large sample hypothesis test for the mean, which means the sample size n is bigger or equal than 30, and we're going to use the p-value method. So let's read the definitions. Definition says a null hypothesis, I'm reading right here, a null hypothesis h sub 0 contains equalities such as less or equal, bigger or equal, or equal. And then the alternate hypothesis, H sub A, is a complement of H sub 0. It contains the strict inequality, such as less, strictly less, strictly bigger, or not equal. So what's the logic? The logic here is, if H sub 0 is not true, then H sub A is true, because one is the complement of the other one. So let's do this example. The CEO of the firm claims that the mean work day of the firm's accountant is less than 8.5 hours. A random sample of 35 of the firm's accountants has a mean work day of 8.2 hours with a standard deviation of 0.5 hours. At a level significance, alpha equals 0.01, test the CEO's claim. So what's the method? So let's look at each step. Step one, we always write the claim, H sub zero, null hypothesis, and the alternate hypothesis. So we start always with the claim. What is the claim? The CEO of the firm claims, right here, claims what? That the mean work day is less than 8.5. So the first thing I do, I'm going to write the claim, which is mu is less than 8.5. And then I'm going to write, this is a claim, right? Now, what's next? So I wrote the claim. Then you need to write H sub 0 and H sub A. How do I know the hypothesis, null hypothesis, and the alternate hypothesis? You read here, null hypothesis, remember we just read this, null hypothesis will always have the equality sign in it. So it contains equality. So we know this statement doesn't contain equality, so this has to be the alternate hypothesis because it doesn't contain equality. It's strictly less than 8.5. So now it's easy to find the statement of a null hypothesis. All we do is take the complement of mu less than 8.5. So how do we know the complement? Here's the definition. We need the complement of strictly less, which means we'll look at this one. The complement of strictly less will be bigger or equal. You can read all of them. I mean, we're going to need the next two. For the next two problems, the complement of strictly will be less or equal. The complement of equal will be different. So they complement each other. Anyway, so the complement of less will be bigger or equal. So that's how we know the statement, the null hypothesis statement. All right, so that's in the first step. All right, let's move on to step two. Step two is right here. Step two, we have to look at the sampling distribution of X bar. Well, so maybe we need to read the problem more now. It says, a random sample of 35 of the firm's accountant, in other words, N, is given to be 35, has a mean work day of 8.2. So X bar is equal 8.2 with a standard deviation S is equal 0.5. So that will always be given in the problem. And then the question is, test the CEO's claim. So this is what we always do. We always look at this the mu equal 8.5. Let me do it here. Mu equal 8.5. So what we do, we draw or we think of the sampling distribution of x bar, right? Right here, step two. So if you think about the sampling distribution of x bar, given that mu is equal, what is it, 8.5. So we know mu is equal 8.5. So what is the sampling distribution? Remember sampling distribution, mu x bar, and it's always going to be equal to mu. So in our case, it's just 8.5. Now what else? We need to know the standard deviation of the sampling distribution. How do we calculate the sampling distribution? Let's do it here and then we write it there. Sampling distribution of x bar, the standard deviation of the sampling distribution will be the standard deviation of the population divided by square root of n. But since that's not given, we can estimate it by S over square root of n. We know that S right there is 0.5 square root. We know n is 35. If we use the calculator, we're supposed to get 0.084. So let me write it here. So standard deviation is 0.084. All right. Now, what's the logic? Look here. The logic used is this. Assuming, we always assume that A sub 0 or the null hypothesis is true. Assuming A sub 0 is true, how likely that we would observe X bar equal, what did we get for X bar? 8.2 in our sample. So that's, so remember 8.2 will be somewhere here, right? This is X bar equal, remember those are X bars, right? These axes, these are X bars, all of these axes. So we want to know how likely, so in other words, to know that, we want to know, is X bar equal 8.2 is likely or very unlikely? In other words, we need to calculate the probability of X bar being 8.2 or less. So how do we do that? Remember, use your calculator, use a normal CDF. Remember, we're trying to find it's this area, right? The probability of X bar less or equal than 8.2 is that area. So how we find it? We keep going from negative 1000, for example, negative 1000 to 8.2. And all we need is, the mean, which is 8.5, and we need the sampling standard deviation, which is 0.084. Now, if you use your calculator, you're supposed to get, let me see what I got, 0.300178. So that's, let's write it here. So 0.000, in other words, 17, if you want to exactly 1775. So it's less, it's unlikely that we're going to get that sample. Well, what do we mean? I mean, how do you know if it's unlikely or likely? That's going to be given in the problem. So in the problem, you'll always be given the level of significance. So the level of significance that we get in is 0.01. What do we mean with that? First of all, this probability that we calculate, we always call it a p-value. So let me do this. P-value is equal that. So we call it p-value. Now look at the definition. Definition says if p-value is less or equal than alpha, the level of significance, then we reject A0. because it's very unlikely that we're gonna observe that sample mean 8.2, like in our case. And if it's strictly bigger than alpha, then we fail to reject A0. So in our case, p-value is equal 0.0001775, and the alpha is equal 0.01. So p-value is less or equal than alpha, right? Which is 0.01. So therefore, look at this. Therefore, we will reject A0. So therefore, we reject the null hypothesis. Now, when we reject the null hypothesis, we have to write the interpretation, right? So again, when you do interpretation, you need to write, to look at the, it's right here. There's two ways to do interpretation. This is what we call the claim. So if these two cases, if the decision, if the claim is H0 or the claim is HA. So in our case, where is the claim? The claim is right here. It's in H sub A. So claim is H sub A. We're right there. See, the claim is A sub A. So we have two cases. We have the case of reject A0, which is our case. See, we reject A0. So this is how you need to interpret it. So how do we interpret? Since we reject A0, then we will say there is enough evidence. There is enough evidence to support the claim. So what is the claim? You need to look at the problem. What is the claim right here? The mean work day. What is the claim? That the mean work day of the firm's accountants is less than 8.5. And that's it for this example. Remember, we never say the claim is true or is false. We say we have enough evidence to support, or we don't have enough evidence to support. By the way, here it's supposed to be there's not enough evidence to support the claim. Yeah, I just didn't finish the whole tape. So there's only two cases. Either there is evidence to support the claim, like in our case, because we reject H0, and let's assume we fail to reject H0, then we say there is not enough evidence to support the claim. And that's it for this example.